have been called according to his purpose. Every loss you think you may suffer, God already is working restoration for you. God already is working it out for you. And thirdly, we see Ruth that was married. If you look at Ruth chapter 1 verse 4, Ruth was married to Mahlon for 10 years and didn't have any child. Ruth was married to Mahlon for 10 years and she did not have a child. No wonder, you know, when the elders, when the women were praying for her, they said, God will make you like Rachel and Leah. For 10 years with Mahlon, she had no child. But the very first year of marriage to Boaz, boom, a boy came. In fact, the very first night of encounter, boom, the goal was scored. And this is a woman that for 10 years, her womb was closed. Was it that she was barren? No. No. It was that the womb was reserved and preserved. God reserved and preserved it for something very unique and special. And that's why we need to know, in our highs and in our lows, that they are all part of God's grand plan. At least for us that are children of God, I'm talking about. I'm not talking about everybody. I'm not talking about everybody. Those of us that are children of God, everything about us, all every areas of everything about us, we have become part of God's plan, God's agenda. It wasn't that this woman couldn't have a child. It was that I won't respond for a particular thing. God had need of it for something that was part of his grand plan. Because the moment she got married to Boaz, within the first year, in fact, look at Ruth chapter 4. Look at how the scripture put it in Ruth chapter 4, verse 13. Ruth 4:13 said, so Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife, and when he went into her, the Lord gave her conception. Who gave her conception?
The Lord.
So who was blocking conception?
The Lord.
The Lord gave her conception, and she bore a son. God gave her conception. But for 10 years with Mahlon, God didn't give her conception. God didn't give her conception. But when the time was come for God's plan, for her to be plugged into God's great plan, God opened up the way. The very first encounter with Boaz, she conceived. And God gave her a son. Now let's look for that. God gave her the child. And look at what the neighborhood said. Look at what the neighborhood women, look at verse 17. Verse 17 of Ruth chapter 4. Ruth 4:17. Also, the neighbor women gave him a name, saying, there is a son born to Naomi. And they called his name Obed. Son born to who?
No.
Who went to labor? How can people be this insensitive? How can people be this insensitive? Who carried the pregnancy for 9 months? So how can anybody send a son born to them? And you know the reason is this. Architect, okay. The reason is this. Boaz came as a kinsman redeemer to raise an offspring for the family of Naomi. And so in the real sense of it, the son was Naomi's son. The son was Mahlon's son. Because Boaz came as a kinsman redeemer, isn't it? And the essence was to raise an offspring for the dead, so that the name of Mahlon will not be wiped out. And so in the real sense of it, you see the women who said, Women are very, very intuitive, very smart.
Thank you.
I know a few times I have messed with their intuition, yeah. And I got burnt real bad. You know, when the women said, David, oh, Saul killed his thousand. David killed. They were very right. They got it excellently right. It's just that sometimes the truth can be hard to swallow. And I think that's part of the thing. That's part of the issue with men sometimes. The truth can be very hard for us to swallow. And then our egos will get in the way. And then we don't want to hear again. Until we learn. And so they said, there is a son born to Naomi. A son born to Naomi. And we see here that the focus was not on Ruth. The focus was not on Boaz. The focus was on Naomi and the child. Why? Boaz was a king's man charged with the responsibility of raising up an offspring to perpetuate the name of Malon. Also, to show that Naomi's claim that the Lord brought her back empty from Moab was not true. So if we could just learn to wait and trust God, all our complaints against God, God will prove untrue. If we can just wait and trust Him, all of our issues and complaints, because we have complaints against Him, we may not be saying them. We won't be denying it to ourselves. But you know, there are occasions that we feel that, God, I expect to have gone beyond where I am today. What's happening? I do this, like the Pharisee. I do this. I do that. You know, the Pharisaical spirit. I do this. I'm like this. I'm like that. I don't miss church. I don't miss this. I'm very kind and magnanimous and like this. Very gracious. And then, you know, you just roll out your resume. And then you feel that God is not dealing fairly with you. But if we can be patient, if we can wait and trust, all of our complaints, whether silent or loud, God will prove untrue. So we see the story began with Naomi's loss, but it ends with what? Naomi's gain. It began with death, and then it ended with the birth of a son. And the son was for Naomi. And everybody knew. Everybody knew. Because they didn't need anyone to tell them. The neighbors, all of them, they said, this is Naomi's son. This is Naomi's son. Look, 17. That's the climax of the story of Naomi. Let's read that 17 one more time. Look. Ruth 4:17. Also, the neighbor women gave him a name, saying, there is a son born to Naomi, and they called his name Obed. We see this verse 17 as the great destination of Naomi's long and twisted journey. That's our place in history, our connection to eternity past, and our connection to eternity future. And look at it, go back there again. They called his name Obed. He is the father of who? Of Jesse, the father of... They were careful to put that there. To let you know that, you know, the fact that Ruth just had Obed was not the end of the story. God was going somewhere. God was going somewhere. And where was God going? God was going somewhere. God was going to David. There was a connection to David, the greatest king Israel ever had. And when you talk about David, you will not forget to talk about Jesus Christ. There's no way you talk about David that you won't talk about Jesus. There's no way. Because Jesus is referred to as the Son of God, the Son of David. And so you see, just as we see that Naomi's life started with the loss, but God was doing his work. God was up to something. And God was not just up to something, God was up to something bigger than Naomi herself. And that's one lesson we need to know, that our life, Your life is bigger than you. Your life is bigger than you. You know, a lot of times we think it is all here. It is bigger than this. It's bigger than this. We need to recognize that. We need to know that everything that is happening in our life, they are all very significant. Every matter is significant. And they all form part of God's grand agenda. God's, well, I said it here before, that, you know, we are all like puzzle pieces on a puzzle board. And God is shifting the pieces, putting each piece in its rightful place, so that the perfect picture can emerge. So that it's part, because God is the only one. You know, that foundational scripture says, eyes have not seen, ears have not heard what God has in store. You have not seen it, I have not seen it. God is the only one who knows the perfect picture that he's painting, or what the perfect picture will look like when all the pieces are in their rightful positions. And so God is moving the pieces. He's moving the pieces. He's moving the pieces. And at the end of age, we will see the picture. We will see the picture. But what is expected of us is for us to be faithful, is for us to trust in him, and is for us to wait on him. And so we see Ruth chapter 4 verse 17 as the great destination of Naomi. When she lost her husband and sons, God gave her Ruth. But Ruth didn't mean anything to her. When she could think of no kinsman to raise up offspring for the family name, God gave her Boaz. And when the barren Ruth married Boaz, God gave them the child. And that's why they said, they called the child Obed. And Obed, the father of Jesse. Jesse, the father of David. All of a sudden, we realize that all along, something far greater has been in the offing than anyone could imagine. God was up to something bigger than all of them, and none of them could imagine it. God was not only plotting for the temporal blessing of a Jew, of a few Jews in Bethlehem. He was preparing for the coming of the greatest king that Israel will have, David. And the name of David carried with it the hope of the Messiah. The new age, peace, righteousness, freedom from pain and crying, grief and guilt. And we see the simple little story opens out like a stream into a great river of hope. And same is with you. Same is with me. That the simple story of my life is going to open up like a stream. It's going to open up like a stream into a great river of hope. The same thing with you, the same thing with me. God is up to something that is bigger than you and I. God wants you to know that when you follow him, your life always will mean more than you can think. For the Christian, there is always a connection between the ordinary events of life and the marvelous work of God in history. Everything we do in obedience to God, no matter how small, is significant. It is part of a great picture which God is painting, to display the greatness of his power and wisdom to the world and to the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 10. The Bible says, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church. By who? The manifold wisdom of God is going to be made known by who? By the church. To the principalities and powers in the heavenly places. And so, serving a widowed mother-in-law, gleaning in a field, falling in love, having a baby, for the Christian, these things are all connected to eternity. For the Christian, all these things are connected to where? They are not just ordinary things. They are connected to eternity. They are part of something so much bigger than they seem. That's why we need to remain faithful. You know, sometimes you may feel like Peter going around up here. You know, Peter came to Jesus and you say, "Hey, Lord, we have left everything and we are following you. We look like fools. What is in this for us?" He asked him the question. He said, "What is in this for us? We have left everything and we are following you like zombies. What is in this for us?" And Jesus responded. Jesus said, "Whatever you leave, whoever has left houses, whoever has left anything for my sake," he said, "in this life you will get it back 100 times.
Amen.
And then he said, "In the life to come, eternal life."
Amen.
You see, he just didn't say you will get it back here alone. He connected it with what? With eternity.
Amen.
So our lives does not just start and end here. Your life started long before you got here. And long after you live here, your life continues.
Amen.
You are part of God's grand agenda.
Amen.
And that's why your best is yet to come.
Amen.
Let's stand on our feet.